Well, marketing and communication trends in the Hispanic social media 2016 update, and a group of South Florida leading Hispanic marketing and communication executives will examine what's trending in the U.S. Hispanic market and multicultural social media, advertising and communications. We're going to join the conversation of the future of Hispanic social media. And the person in charge of that is Manny, who is the expert and a dear friend. So it is an honor to have you here.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. We're going to hopefully have a great program today. I think it'll be fun. We'll learn a lot. And I'm very excited to have the panelists that I have here. From my left to my right, I will introduce very briefly. We're starting late, so we're not going to spend too much time on biography, but I will just briefly tell you a little bit about each of them because I happen to know all of them in one way or the other. So from my left to my right, I have Cynthia McFarland. She's the managing director of NewLink. And NewLink is a leading agency here in Miami. They work with many blue chip companies, including Coca-Cola, who she's going to talk to us about some of the secrets to the Coke. Not to how you make Coke, but, you know, the secrets to social media and Coke. They've won some awards recently for their U.S. Hispanic work, and I'm very honored to have Cynthia McFarland here. In the middle, we have Stephanie Guerrero. She comes at the world of Hispanic social media from a slightly different angle. She works with all of the top Latino music celebrities you can ever dream of. She is part of this family of La Musica and Spanish Broadcasting System, and she is the director of social media for them. So she works with Daddy Yankee, Prince Royce, all of these folks, and through Spanish Broadcasting Systems and their radios, stations here and nationally, she helps amplify brands and how they integrate with the radio and with the now the major music app, which you should download, La Musica, that's online. And then finally, to my immediate left, I have this character, my dear friend, Jorge Plasencia, the founder and CEO, co-founder and CEO of República. And República works with many blue chip clients as well, including Toyota, who we have actually done extensive work together with. So let's hear a round of applause for this panel. We are, by the way, actually, thank you before, I'm sorry. There are two panelists that are missing. One of them, unfortunately, is some of you know, is Mike Valdez Fowley of Pinta. He had a very serious death in his family, and he could not make it here for that reason. So I just want you to know that that's the only reason he's not here. Mike is the president of Pinta. And the other individual, I think, is stuck in some sort of weird traffic situation here in Wynwood, and it's Freddie Balseda. So we'll play it by ear. If he makes it, and he's brave enough to come in later,
there he is.
Oh, my God. In a nick of time, Freddie Balseda. How you doing, brother? Freddie Balseda actually brings another unique perspective. He's the president of Balseda Communications, and Freddie will bring the perspective of public affairs, public policy, reaching Latinos through social media campaigns and programs. So he's going to bring a completely different angle than everybody. So I'm really, really excited about this panel, and I think you will too when you see what they're going to share. So without further ado, now we can do the claps. Thank you very much. So look, we have a limited amount of time, and I want to be very respectful to starting. We're probably going to run a little bit over, just so you know. But I did want to get right into it. So what I'd like to ask each of you is if you can share with us, and we'll start with you, Cynthia. Can you tell us an example of Coca-Cola, for example, being one of the leading brands and how they activate in social media with Latinos? What are some of the success formulas of the way that Coca-Cola activates and engages Latinos online? And, you know, what are some of the best practices that you think you've seen? And I will ask the same question for each of you. I know that you represent many brands, so let's perhaps just pick on one with each of you and tell us about, like, one of those brands that you're all especially excited about and that you see that they do some interesting things. So, Cynthia, go ahead.
Thanks, Manny. Is this working? Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So,
I know.
I mean, we've got quite a few case studies from Coca-Cola that we've been able to build with them over the years. One of them was won a Tecla Award this year, which was a t-shirt exchange, the jersey exchange that we did for Coca-Cola, which was a really interesting way for Coca-Cola to bring together soccer fans from both Mexico and the U.S. So that was a really fun campaign that got a tremendous amount of traction. But I think in terms of best practices, I think first and foremost, the key is having a really in-depth, really deep cultural understanding and really deep insights into the consumer, into what moves consumers, and then having the ability to use all of the tools that we have at our disposal, including social media, obviously, so that we can tell stories that will engage consumers. So in reality, insight-driven activity is that insights have to be behind everything that we do, for starters. I think that the other thing when we talk about influencer marketing and in the influencer space, the key to the success there really is being able to find a common purpose between the brand and the influencer that we're engaging. There was a really interesting article in this month's Fast Company that talks about Generation Z, which obviously is it's between ages 5 and 20, I believe it is. But it is a generation that is super important to Coca-Cola because of their core target, no? And this is a generation that is, more than any generation that preceded them, they are the ones that are most jaded about corporate America and most jaded about brands and advertising at large. So purpose is key because it has to be about being authentic, and it has to be also transparent. It also has to be about being transparent. And as long as you can align with an influencer that has a narrative that is similar to the brand that you are attempting to partner them with, then you have a recipe for success. But anything that's inauthentic, anything that reeks of lack of transparency is going to do more harm than good for your brand. So those would be the two things.
And we're going to expand later on some of the influencer traits and characteristics of what you're looking at. So keep that in mind, guys. Stephanie?
Hi,
would you like to share? What brand do you want to talk about today?
Sure. I want to talk about Ritmo 95.7, which is a brand that I was even a little skeptical about. It's a new radio station we launched in Miami, Cubatón y Más. I thought the genre was limited. I thought there were very few artists. But to be honest, social media was the one that kind of dictated why we went into that format. And there was a lot of demand for this music. And I think a key to social media is listening. And we did a lot of social listening. We looked at all the audiences. There were more and more Cuban population moving into Miami at this moment. They love this music. They love music from where they come from. And there are tons of artists up and coming. So we launched this station. It has blown up. We had an ad campaign. Within the first day, we had a 4% CTR, which not sure if you guys are familiar with that, but that was amazing. It blew everything out of the water, and it was completely unexpected. And to be honest, I'm so happy that we listened to our audience because they gave us this gift, and now we are participating together in building this brand.
So if I'm correct, you're saying that what drove the growth that you were able to expand on was listening first. Before you came out, you did some listening, which kind of resonates with what Cynthia said.
Yeah.
You do a lot of listening and a lot of auditing of, you know, what's being said, what's going on, so that you can fit into that.
Definitely, yeah. And that's how we knew it was going to be a relevant brand, because we listened.
Jorge, you've worked with Toyota, which does some pretty cool stuff. What have you noticed? It doesn't have to be Toyota, by the way. I know you work with a lot of other brands on the social side, but who do you want to talk about, and what are they doing right, smart? What are some of the success tips that you have?
Well, I think what's interesting, like most of us up here, you know, we're totally bicultural, and we live in both worlds, as I like to say. We consume media in both languages, and a lot of the people, and we live in both languages, a lot of the people we market to and we communicate to on behalf of brands do the same thing. Recently, for a Cava brand that we're actually AOR for this brand, pretty much, you know, for the country and other parts of the world. It's called Segura Viudas. It's a cava from Spain.
Segura what?
Segura Viudas. It's a cava from Spain. If you've never tasted or tried it, I highly recommend it. They're our client. I highly recommend it. we launched a new spot, and we actually launched it only online. It was only online video, and in a matter of, I think it was 3 days, it has close to 200,000 views and that sort of thing. What I'm getting at is, you know, we targeted that campaign very specific to people that we know, number one, that are millennials, and number two, that would be open to drinking cava, you know, open to drinking sparkling wine, and it's been a success. So that's one. Another huge one is Toyota. You know, Toyota, you know, we've partnered with Manny now for three years as the official automotive sponsor of Hispanicize. And what we've done there, we've used Hispanicize as a platform. You know, because I feel that brands at those sorts of events, be it Hispanicize, South by Southwest, or any of these events, even this event, it's all about how you activate. It's all about how you use that platform and then showcase it to the world. And I think with Toyota, I'm very proud that we've been able to use Hispanicize as this platform to get the message out there, to align with influencers, to align with ambassadors. I mean, Hispanicize for Toyota has been one of their biggest and most successful social media pushes, and that's been because it's been worked on hand in hand with us, the client, and you all, and kind of bringing that together, using those insights, using those learnings that we've had, having Toyota as a client now for several years. Every year, I think we're able to increase our success at Hispanicize and at other similar events and festivals and conferences across the country. You know, the formula from Hispanicize, we've actually copied that formula, and we're using that.
Great.
And we're using that at other places because it is a best practice. It has become a best practice. You know, that social media wall, for example, people love seeing when they tweet or when they're going to win something, they love seeing their tweet up. So now that social media wall is something that we're using at other events across the country. So
that's, I mean, interesting, it's, because you're bringing the perspective right now of not just the social media engagement that we think of as just being with your laptop and your computer, but you're talking about the social media live activation of a program at an event.
I think the biggest thing today is about the live activation, because you have this really captivated audience for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 days, and you're engaging them in such a way that they're, what they're doing is continuously, you know, kind of feeding to their spheres of influence all sorts of information with that hashtag Vayamos Juntos and with your hashtag. So it's just such an opportunity within a really, really concentrated amount of time to get a lot of content out to, you know, hundreds of thousands, millions of people. So we've seen that, you know, using social around these big marquee tentpole events as a really successful thing. We've also seen it, you know, obviously one of our clients is Telemundo. They've had huge success, you know, using social. I was at the Premios do Mundo, and backstage, was walking through backstage, and I get into this room, and it was a room a little bigger than this room with desks. And there must have been 50, 60 content people that were there specifically to feed content for Telemundo. It's just for them. Anything that was happening on the carpet, on backstage, on stage, everywhere, in the green rooms, wherever, they were feeding that out. And that is all content that obviously, you know, the audience is dying to get. They're dying to get those nuggets of content. So that's what we're doing, you know, at these big events for Toyota and for other clients.
Freddie, you do a couple things differently than everybody here, because you're involved. You know, Freddie's been a part of helping elect President Obama. He's now involved, I think, in some direction with Hillary Clinton, and he's arguably the most connected Latino in South Florida, and one of them nationwide. You can look that up, by the way. Google it. You'll see it's true.
After George.
So, Freddie.
After George.
After George.
Yes.
George, future mayor of Miami, by the way, everyone. I'd love to embarrass him like that. But no, on a serious note, you know, Freddie, how do you do outreach and engagement strategies to the Latino community via social media? It's got to be different, not just because of the language, but the culture. What are some of the things that you see, and what is maybe one campaign or program?
Well, like Manny said, a lot of what I do is different from these folks here. So we focus on public interest issues, public policy issues, and political issues. And I want to answer your question talking about the last three election cycles, because if you go back to 2004, when John Kerry challenges George W. Bush. And those of you that followed that race may recall the Swift Boat Veteran commercial. And it actually became a term. Now, when they say they're going to swift boat you, everybody knows what you're talking about. Well, can you imagine that that spot only had $100,000 behind it? And its dissemination was truly in social media, when social media, we're talking 12 years ago,
was
in an infancy stage. So they basically put the spot up, they spread it through earned media and then through social media, and it was probably the most impactful spot of that race. Fast forward to 2008, when you had the Obama campaign as the first campaign ever to have a Facebook account, first campaign ever to have a dedicated social media apparatus, and the first presidential candidate to be sending out tweets. And people think that Obama was tweeting from the beginning, but if you look it up, it wasn't until the last few months of the campaign that that phenomenon started. And it caught the McCain campaign entirely flat-footed. And he started engaging with this whole new universe of people that otherwise weren't consuming political news or information from traditional sources. Now you go to this election cycle, and you basically have a presidential candidate with millions of followers who communicates primarily through Twitter, and everything he tweets becomes headline news everywhere. And all of a sudden, you have political candidates. And it's the most amazing thing for me, because we talked about authenticity. We talked about, I think somebody mentioned discipline, but there has to be a certain level of discipline in these things. You have political candidates that are responding to their attacks by Twitter. So in my world, social media has become, without question, one of the most cost-effective and also influential drivers of information, access, and engagement. Because if you have a political campaign and you want to be on TV in Miami alone or in Florida, it's going to cost you, you know, $500,000. In Miami, it's going to cost you $250,000. So being able to engage with your target audience and activate and mobilize your supporters through social media becomes incredibly cost effective. And using those three examples, you're seeing how it's building more and more significance in these political campaigns.
With regards to Latinos, though, how does that manifest itself?
Like, it's the same.
What are some of the nuances? Is there any nuance of how you've done something with Latino electorate?
The most important thing is to recognize that there is no pan-Hispanic. Hispanics are different. So whether it's paid media or social media, you have to tailor the message to the people in that particular community based on the experiences that they have. So for example, a Latino in Miami, whether you're Cuban, Nicaraguan, Venezuelan, Colombian, or Argentine, feels empowered. They live in a community where Hispanics are empowered. That's very different from a Latino in Phoenix who lives in a county with one of the most racist sheriffs in the country. So the message has to be directed at those people so that it resonates in these specific audiences.
Geo-targeting messages is more crucial than ever.
And it needs to be, like you mentioned, authentic. It can't be something translated that was meant for an English-speaking audience. So what you're seeing now is Hispanic teams in these political campaigns directing the messages specifically for those Hispanic audiences.
Regardless of language?
Irrespective of language. Awesome. Because like George says, you know, it's a bicultural, bilingual community that sometimes wants information in English, other times they're going to consume it in Spanish.
So let me turn over to the topic of influencers, which is one of my favorite. We have this love-hate relationship, right? Sometimes I hear it from the agencies. They're like, oh, my God. No, they all love them. They all love them. But, I mean, I remember in 2010, anecdotally, when we did the first Hispanicize, we introduced the idea of influencers, Latino influencers, getting paid for opportunities to work with brands and agencies. And I remember the initial reaction from agencies is like, this is payola, it's wrong. You know, it's a lot of allergic reactions to that. This world has evolved. Now we know that, you know, we acknowledge the work that influencers are doing, the value that they present, and the fact that, you know, they're like mini celebrities. In some cases, they're as big as a celebrity, and Very few cases, but there are. There are some that are as big as many celebrities. So in the midst of this whirlwind change where they've become now one of the biggest people that you deal with, you know, with your brands and messaging, what are some of the things that you think is important when working with Latino influencers? And I'll start with Cynthia Negron. I know you've done a lot of work with Latinos.
Yeah, we've done a lot of work for Coca-Cola. Again, we've done a lot of work with influencer networks as well as outside of influencer networks. Dime is a great example of a network that we partner with quite a bit, and we did some work for a program that Coca-Cola has. It's called For the Dream, which basically is a program that enables Hispanic families to get their kids into university, into college. It's a beautiful, beautiful program that they have that we actually engaged Dime to execute it, an influencer strategy around it. I think, again, it goes back to the point of regardless of whether or not it's a Latino influencer or if it's a general market influencer, the key really needs to be about being able to find an influencer that has a purpose that is similar to what it is that you're trying to purport, A, and B, that already has a narrative that is similar to the narrative that you're trying to engage. Because ultimately, and referring back to this Fast Company article that I was talking about, in Gen Z in particular, what the article purports is that because of the skepticism that there is towards brands, people from Generation Z are more receptive to a message from a peer than they are from an actual company.
That's an excellent point. Yeah.
Because and particularly if it's an influencer that they already have a relationship with and that they're seeing that this is just a continuation of the narrative that they have. So I think that it's an incredible tool for us to leverage. And we've just touched the tip of the iceberg in terms of how it is that we're using influencers, because obviously we have to do a lot of work in terms of being able to put metrics around this beyond reach and beyond impressions so that we can really drive it home as a new strategy, as a mainstream strategy for our clients.
Stephanie, and I think it's to your point, Cynthia, the younger and younger the target audience, yeah, the more you're going to really need the influencers. Yeah. Is that correct? Do you think that it definitely is the credibility factor and the I'll probably believe this brand that I'm kind of jaded about,
right,
increases with the younger the target audience?
Definitely. And I think the key for brands is to listen to the influencer and what messages they're already portraying. Get to know their brand so that you know if you actually fit with them or not, if it's authentic. In my case, you know, I have an advantage because music is very relatable to everybody. So, you know, as long as the concert, you know, Liza, who's here, is sitting in the front row, she went to one of our concerts and she tweeted and got retweeted a bunch of times. So it's a lot easier, but it's very important that you listen to what the influencers already, the message that they're already portraying, what they care about. If they haven't taken a stance on a particular issue, maybe reach out to them, find out what it is, if they're even interested in that issue at all. But that's the key for brands, because the most important thing for the influencer is their authenticity and their identity, and you don't want to go against that.
George, with respect to the same question, are there sometimes that you haven't worked with an influencer because of some reason or another? Can you talk about a case?
I mean, yeah. I mean,
without mentioning the name.
Well, I think as our team is looking at which influencers to engage with for a brand. Yeah, I mean, I think you got to go deep into understanding that influencer, what he or she believes, what they stand for. You know, are they controversial? Is there anything political? Is there anything regarding any topic that in any way can affect your brand? So yeah, I mean, we do go through some of those kind of checks and balances as we look at influencers, because that really is important. I mean, it really is important. One of our accounts is the National Pork Board. You know, if we're going to work with an influencer that has publicly said that they don't eat pork or that they don't believe
save
in
the pork.
You know, right, or they right, it's, you know, but think about it. It's important that the person, going back to your word, be authentic, and that there be authenticity. Not that all of a sudden he or she is saying, oh, you got to eat bacon and pork and yada yada, and it's great for, you know, it's healthy, you know, pork is healthy, and it's this and it's that, and these are the cuts. But then, you know, you go back and you're like, this person was speaking ill of of the product. So I think that's really, really important. That's really, really important, that authenticity, really understanding that person. And I think what happens sometimes is, you know, we just say we work with DMIR or we work directly with influencers, but we really don't have these conversations with them to really get to know the influencer. I really believe it has to be a symbiotic relationship. It has to be a relationship where it's something good for the influencer. You're giving them a platform. You're giving them an opportunity to be aligned with a brand or to be aligned with an issue or whatever it is, but vice versa. They're giving you an opportunity to be aligned with their brand and their issues and what have you. So I think it has to be symbiotic. It can't be a one-way street influencer to brand or brand to influencer. It has to be a two-way street. The other thing is, going back to Generation Z, there was a lot of learnings that we all had. I had the opportunity of moderating a panel with Generation Z kids at Hispanicize this year, and it was really eye-opening. One of the biggest things was that they are open to celebrities, they are open to influencers, but there can't be any,
can't fake it?
You're right, you can't fake it. It has to be authentic. And that was clear about that. The other thing that I have to say is we can't forget about celebrities too, because there are celebrities that in their sphere of influence are influencers. There are some that are,
super celebs.
Right, super celebs. We worked, again, going back to National Pork Port, recently we worked with Angelica Valle. Her fans love her. She's an actress, you know, from Mexico, lives in Los Angeles now. She's on Telemundo. She has several million fans. They love her. I mean, the relationship that she has with her fans, she's always replying to them, and there's that relationship. So what I'm getting at there is, on the influencer side, super important, but also there are some celebrities that are very down to earth, very humble, and very open to speaking about a product in a very authentic way. You know, with the National Pork Board, she spoke to and keeps speaking to its health benefits. She has two young kids, the health benefits of eating pork. Obviously, in our communities, in Latino communities, many times we may not cook it in the most healthy ways. You know, how we cook our foods, right? We over-index on pretty much all chronic diseases. You know, so what part of our messaging with Angelica is that healthy eating, you know, about getting that message out.
Freddie, I have never seen Dime specifically work on anything that has to do with politics. And I'm not sure, how does that play with influencers and politics and public affairs? I mean, is there such a thing as influencer marketing?
There is.
How does it work with Latinos? Because I've never seen it.
And I'm going to give you two very different examples. Here in the U.S., as it relates to Hispanic influencers in the political space, by far, Jorge Ramos takes the lead. He's the most influential Hispanic in the country, beyond any artist or entertainer or actor. And since he operates almost as an activist more than a bland journalist, his opinion matters, and his opinion moves people. And he's very vocal about his opinion. So I would say that he's definitely at the top of the totem pole. But you also have some younger journalists that have attended Hispanicize, like Hispanic journalists like Ed O'Keefe from the Washington Post, Adrian Carraquillo from BuzzFeed, who are creating a new model of journalism in which in print they're reporting the facts, but on social media they're very open about giving you their opinion. And they're creating conversations around Hispanic-related issues around politics. Yesterday, Ed came out with an article on Helen Aguirre Ferre, who we know and love. She's now the chief Hispanic spokesperson for the RNC. And the question was, how does someone who has had such a strong record against Donald Trump become now his biggest advocate in the Hispanic community as the spokesperson for the RNC? And that created all kinds of conversations on social media as a result of the article, which was a fair and balanced article. So I think you're seeing these kinds of names.
Now, those are journalists, though. But, I mean, are there influencers? Are there people like Liza Morales who's here in the audience, or Kathy Hack, or some of the other influencers here? I mean, do you work with other influencers outside of the Jorge Ramos? And
no, the influencers, I think, are columnists, are journalists. The people that would serve as an influencer typically are in the campaigns. They're not necessarily people that are driving messages and influencing from from abroad. Now, that's an example here in the U.S. If you...
Now, wait. Before I let you... I'm not going to let him off the hook so easy. Okay, no, but... All right, so that has to do with the political campaigns. But,
yes.
But what about public affairs issues, like a health initiative or stuff like that? Is that when you do connect with the, you know, the non-journalist influencers?
Now, on the public interest side...
Yes.
Like you mentioned, celebrities are typically the ones that influence public opinion, whether it's the environment or climate change. Look, Al Gore is an influencer on climate change. When you think of, you know, saving pets or you think of the environment, there typically is one or two celebrities. When you talk about massacres in parts of the world, there's typically one or two celebrities that drive influence in those areas and lend their credibility and their network of followers to those issues. Brad Pitt, for example, with the flooding after the hurricane in New Orleans. So yes, in those areas, typically celebrities are the ones that lend their network of followers to create noise and conversation on issues.
So, question for all of you. I mean, all of these platforms are evolving so quick. You could say this over and over every month because it just changed again. As far as you're concerned, we obviously are always talking a lot about the millennials. It's the hottest topic in the Hispanic and multicultural marketing world. What would you say are some of the, if you were to rank them, 1, 2, 3, let's just go through that a little bit of the exercise here. What do you think are the top three, number 1 to 3, platforms that to engage influencers, I'm sorry, to engage millennials, Latino millennials, in social media right now?
Well, I think that if you're talking about millennials and younger audiences specifically, the platforms that have more to do with video, with imagery, are the ones that are the most attractive to millennials. Facebook obviously has been integrating a lot of that technology or acquiring. I mean, they already have a huge base to begin with. But I think that because the trend is moving more and more towards video and any platform that has video capability are the platforms of the future.
Stephanie, you're right there in the front lines.
I think it depends on what is the message that you're trying to convey. But I would say definitely Snapchat and Instagram are leading the way right now. Instagram released their stories, which was kind of a thing, but it's not the same as Snapchat. And I'm personally a user of all the networks, obviously.
Even with the change at Instagram,
it's not the same because Snapchat's nature was a messaging app. It was not a social network. It was a messaging app. So you can't, Instagram couldn't do away with that. You know, they have direct messages, but it's not the same feeling. And yes, it gets silly with the stickers and you can add lenses and all of that, but it's not just that. Snapchat at its core is a messaging app and it's so great for communicating. It's so much easier to cut through all of the excess on Snapchat. So I would say definitely Snapchat and Instagram are leading the way, but it depends on the message you're trying to convey. And if you want to speak, you know, to moms or an older generation, you want to go to Facebook or Pinterest. It really depends on the message, but I would say Snapchat and Instagram are leading right now.
Hold it real quick, and then Freddie, politics side, you can use these.
Obviously YouTube is still, I think, really important for, you know, across the board, but really millennials, I feel, are getting a lot of their content through there. I just wanted to go back to what Freddie was saying about politics, because I think it's important. I mean, we do have some other voices, like on the Republican side that are Latino. You have like Ana Navarro. You know, she's out there a lot speaking to issues. And then you have, then obviously you had Donna Brazile. You have people like that I think may not be journalists, but are people that they may be contributors, you know, and hired contributors by the networks. They're pundits, but I think people see them as representative of a community. You know, when Anna speaks, I think people say, okay, this is how Hispanics feel. So just want to say that.
Freddie, in the public affairs and politics, do you guys use any of the social media apps? I think Facebook sounds like the most natural one, right?
Facebook is like on the checklist. You're running for office, whether it's city councilman or U.S. senator, you have to have a Facebook page.
Facebook and Twitter, I guess, are the for politics.
But I think in politics, the most effective one and the most widely used is by far Twitter. Because with Twitter, you're driving more messages, you're being succinct with your messages. What I was going to say earlier is that when you go outside of the U.S. and you go into places like Latin America, it is amazing to see the level of reach and activity that presidential candidates have in Latin America through social media, especially, for example, in Argentina. We do work in Argentina. We opened up an office here. And the level of engagement by Argentine politicians, Argentine opinion makers, journalists through Twitter is just—it's just crazy. The Argentine president Mauricio Macri, if you look at his Twitter account, he's enormously active, constantly putting news and information there. So I would say definitely here in the U.S. for Hispanics, for non-Hispanics, and in South America and Central America, Twitter is the most effective tool.
That's interesting because a lot of people would say, hey, Twitter, you know, but it's become like the platform for athletes and others to put out statements like, hey, oh, that's not true. And then Twitter is where you hear their most authentic reaction.
It's more for thought leadership. Get your opinion out there, what you're thinking at that moment, you know, what comes to mind or heart at that moment. I think that's what Twitter's for. And that's why all these politicians use it.
And if, you know, in a couple of weeks, we're going to have the first presidential debate. You will see on your Twitter feed that anybody that has any kind of relation to politics or interest in politics is going to be using Twitter, not Facebook or Snapchat, is going to be using Twitter as the debate is going on to give you their insights and their thoughts and their opinions on what's being said and what's happening.
Let me turn over to the topic of measuring success in social media, which we know is very hard. Some platforms have social media, you know, they have tech walls where they won't let you penetrate to see what everything that's being said just because they're trying to protect privacy, blah, blah, blah. You know, Twitter tends to be the most open one in terms of being able to capture everything that's been said from a specific platform. But how do you guys, when you're working with a program or a campaign for a client, how are you guys talking about measuring success? What are some of the metrics that you're using, and maybe if you could please mention what's your social listening tool that you prefer, just out of preference?
So we have a very healthy tourism practice, and we've used social media quite a bit, Facebook in particular, to do demand gen and to do performance campaigns. And I think that all of our clients now are currently talking about how it is that I can tie all of my activities back to sales, back to bookings, back to selling tickets. And so Facebook gives us the ability to really track it through the entire process, all the way down to closing the sale, which is awesome. And the more we can get there, the better. Other clients, obviously, because they don't have necessarily e-commerce, they don't sell their products online, makes it a little bit more difficult. But I think that reach and impressions aren't going to be enough, they're not enough for us really to be able to support social as a strategic tool. And I think that the holy grail is going to be when we can push it further down the purchase funnel and be able to start tying back the sales results or consumption or conversion back to what we're doing in the social media sphere. And it's going to be the holy grail and the company that can come up with it.
So are you saying that Facebook Analytics is what you primarily use? I'm sure you use other tools.
Yeah, we use many other tools. We use Radiant 6. We use Social Bakers. We have quite a broad
Radiant
portfolio.
Radiant 6, Social Bakers, note, guys.
Yeah.
Stephanie?
For me, we really look at engagement as well. For us, it's really important to know that our audience cares about the content that we're sharing. So comments, sharing is key. Engagement is a big analytic, but just like you said, that's not enough anymore because, you know, a like is so easy. It's so low in the totem pole as far as, like, audience engagement goes that engagement as a metric itself is not enough. And I would love if there was a magic tool that would tell me what the return is on how many times people are commenting and who are these commenters, because those are the brand ambassadors you want to get to. Now, I have an amazing team of coordinators who know our audience very well, so we kind of, you know, pinpoint them out, but it's definitely human enforced. It's not any tool. We use Simply Measured. That's one I love a lot. And Nuvi is a big one that is coming up that we love. Those are the tools.
George?
Yeah, I would say that you know, we're onboarding a new client as we speak, and we're putting those KPIs and metrics in place now, you know, that we want to reach. And we work with both ours, and sometimes the brand has their measurement tools that they use. So we complement each other's, and we kind of cross-reference and cross-check. At Republica, we use several, Sysomos being one of the main ones that we'll use, Google Analytics, Facebook Analytics. I mean, we go deep. Freda's here from our media, digital media team, and you know, we go really deep in looking at who did we reach, how did we reach them, how engaged were they. And then the other thing, you know, that's tied to all that, obviously, is at the beginning when you're going to launch a campaign or onboard a new client, is really social listening. Really understand what are the issues that are important to the people that care about this company or this brand, or that don't care about this company or this brand. Because there you have, you know, you have your low-hanging fruit, and then you have the ones that you want to get long-term. You know, how do we get those people that, you know, for myriad reasons, would not shop or not engage with the brand, and are most probably going to be the ones at times saying not so good, nice things about the company or the brand. So social listening, especially at the beginning when you're launching an effort, is so important, and especially when it's a big global brand that does have a lot of people that love the brand, but there's also people that may not for God knows how many reasons.
So Freddie, back to your particular predicament here, public policy. Is it different? Are the tools different? Do you use something different?
So if it's a political campaign, the analytics are none of the ones that were described here. Because
you got that, right? It's a totally different world.
Because there. The number of impressions is good to know, the number of likes is good to know, but ultimately you're measuring based on three external factors. One is money. How did you use social media to raise money? The first guy to do that was Barack Obama. The most recent example of a stellar fundraising operation online was Bernie Sanders, which parenthetically is also should be a Harvard case study on how a, you know, 70-something-year-old curmudgeon can become the candidate of millennials and have such an active social media following despite having no presence in social media himself. It's really something that has to be looked at. But, you know, number one is money. Number two is attendance, because we use social media to drive people to events. So if you have a lot of people at an event, you know that your social media operation went well. And number three is the most obvious, votes. If you won and you had a good social media operation, then you know that things were effective. Now, on the public interest side, it's a little bit different. When we're trying to push an issue, like, for example, we represent FPNL. FPNL has been under a lot of heat because of issues that have come up at Turkey Point and certain contamination.
Higher electric bills.
The increased rates. So there, the fact of the matter is the decisions by the public officials that decide on FPNL's matters is how you ultimately measure if you were effective or not. And we do all the analytics. Because we do want to know in those areas how many people we reach, but we also monitor what the people that we're trying to influence, monitor their responses and monitor what they're telling their followers to see if our work is successful in terms of trying to influence their thought process.
You're completely wired different than everybody else here.
Entirely.
I love that about this panel. I have one other question, and then I want to turn it over to the audience. We might have time for a few questions. So I'll end with this question. With regards to virtual reality and augmented reality, are you guys there yet? Is there anything that you could tell us about what you see coming up with virtual reality and augmented reality? I personally think that next time this year, or even possibly by Hispanicize in April, we're going to have a very big discussion about game-changing technology, because I know some insights that are mind-blowing. It's going to change the way everybody produces content. But what do you think?
Well, we've actually had some really cool successes in virtual reality. I mentioning earlier tourism and some of the work that we've been doing in tourism. Anything that's a destination or anything where you're trying to communicate to a consumer an experience, like a hotel or a hotel room or a destination or a beach, VR is fantastic for it. And we've done some really interesting stuff with the Dominican Tourism Board, and we've done it with a few hotels, and it really is a phenomenal way to bring the experience to the consumer as close as you can possibly get. Another great example, I don't know if you saw the Beyond the Map that Google did for in the favelas in Brazil around the Olympics, was an incredible program that was incredibly beautifully executed on a regular screen as opposed to having to do it with the goggles, which was it was incredibly well done. But the thing about Google and what they did with Beyond the Map, which goes back to a point that I make earlier, is using the technology to tell a story. And that's what VR gives us. It gives us the opportunity to, it gives us, it's other technology and other tools at our disposal to be able to tell beautiful stories that are engaging. So the tech, just VR for VR's sake, isn't really going to deliver what anything if we don't have engaging and powerful stories behind it that really can communicate a brand narrative and that can really engage consumers.
And your agency's ready.
Of course.
Stephanie, anything on the radio front?
I'm going to talk about Pokemon Go because I think that's the biggest augmented reality success of recently. And the key to Pokemon Go is, and as a semi-millennial, I think I'm a little too old to be a millennial, but I mean, it was such a it touched such a sweet spot because I played every Pokemon game when I was growing up. So when Pokemon Go came out, it was the best. And the fact that it
How many of you did Pokemon Go here, just out of curiosity? Let me actually, wait, sorry. Put your hand down.
Nagle.
How many of you did not even care, did not even do it?
Didn't care?
Didn't care at all. All right, so about 25% of you didn't.
Okay. So, I mean, and that was a great opportunity because we were able to jump on board of that and plan events around Pokemon Go and where the Pokestops were, where you could get more Pokemons. And, you know, it provided us a great opportunity to just kind of jump on board and take advantage of that. And I think location-based is going to be amazing. You know, CNCO is a band from La Banda. They revealed their album using that kind of same idea. You had to flock to a specific area, and if enough fans got there, it would unlock the album. And that was amazing to me, the fact that you can discover content through just walking around your city. And I think that, back to your storytelling point, you know, that you can do something amazing and just get people outside and engaging with each other. And maybe, you know, bring your head out of your phone and make you interact
Stephanie,
with other people.
Regarding our conversation yesterday,
yes,
you know, there's something right there you just mentioned. We'll talk about that later.
We can definitely do that.
You know, it goes back to what they're saying. It's got to be, number one, it's got to be, I loved, by the way, the CNCO thing. That I think those sorts of things, I think, are how brands can really use these technologies now. I mean, obviously, there's many ways. I think the more that the technology becomes just mainstream, I think that you will see us engaging with it much more. We're obviously big proponents of it, and you know, we're in talks actually with several clients on several really interesting concepts in regard to VR. You know, we have several clients like Google and Toyota that have been doing things, not as much us tied to them, but they've been doing several major and leading the way, especially on the Google side. So you know, we believe in it, and we want to be a big part of it. You know, we want to be a big part of it.
Freddie, how does this apply to
politics? I wanted to clarify, in the Pokemon Go, I've never played, but when I drive my 12 and 10-year-old in the car, I feel like I'm playing because they've asked me to turn over here so that they can, you know, and they have different names and different values, apparently. So they get really excited when they get the high-value ones.
Can you, like, virtually meet Hillary or something like that, maybe?
Not yet. not yet. But I think on the political side, it's going to take a while. There's so many disciplines that are tried, tested, and proven in the political world that it's hard to introduce new concepts. However, on the public interest side, I foresee that foundations in particular that try to drive attention and messages around issues, since there's so much connection between these issues and the funders of these foundations, like the Gates Foundation, for example. You can rest assured that the Bill Gates Foundation is going to start coming up with some very innovative ways to communicate what it is they're doing. And on the government side, we haven't spoken much about government. We do a lot of work also around government issues. You're going to see here, just in our own backyard in Miami-Dade County, a major leap in the level of technology and the level of innovation in terms of how we operate, how we're engaged, how we report complaints and address public service issues. And you're seeing in governments that it's almost as if these technology companies are showing up, are making a huge leap over the traditional legacy platforms, and the governments are embracing these very inexpensive but very innovative approaches to accomplishing its services and fulfilling its needs to the public. So I think in the next year or so, you're going to see some amazing stuff coming out of the local governments here.
All right, I have more questions, but I think it's only fair that you guys ask questions. We have about 10 minutes. So let's go with her first, and then we'll go with you, young lady. Liza Monet Morales. Jojo Liza in the house, by the way, everybody.
Or suggestions for other influencers for them to use their platform, because that was something actually we talked about, and I put Univision under fire for it, because I said I've actually volunteered, I already have a sign up, I'm getting up at 6 a.m. that day to go meet my followers in Los Angeles, and I'm driving them to the voting polls, I'm getting them registered, I'm like, bring your grandma, bring your aunts, whoever you need, I will go get you tamales, let's go, like, we're gonna vote, we're gonna do this together. So when I said that, people were like, but that's not what you do on the daily, you cover fashion, you cover travel, lifestyle, music. I'm like, yes, but I'm an American and this matters, and if I have a platform, what's the point of me having a platform if I'm not using it for social good? So I actually would encourage and would hope that you guys can also see that and know that there's a lot of influencers that are wanting to use that voice but just don't know how. And so I would turn to you to figure out, is there something, I mean, I'd love to talk to you even more, but is there something that you think are key steps? Because I've realized that I'm one and alone. There's so many people that I've reached out to that are like, I'm scared, Liza, that my following's gonna get mad. You somehow have figured it out. I'm like, what are you talking about? Why are you scared to encourage people to use their voice? Like, this isn't just about money and not getting a deal. You don't even have to be candidate specific. Like, get them involved just to vote. So it kind of broke my heart a little then to hear you say that influencers, you're like, no, I don't actually think influencers have a side on this side. Because if both sides have that disconnect, we're not gonna be able to use and leverage that for the higher good, which is to get people out to vote. So I'd love to just hear your thoughts.
What I've seen is that, first, a lot of these celebrities that can be influencers are very protective of their brand. And when you approach them, like I have many times, and you ask them to get involved, they don't want to get involved because they want to stay out of the political fray and risk upsetting a follower who is not supportive of their ideas. So the ones that actually do it, I have found to be in the minority. The other thing I've found is that in the case of celebrities that you bring into these efforts, very, very few are as specific in their request as you are. Some will lend their name to a concert or to an event. So what I've also seen is that celebrities don't drive votes. And people don't vote for someone because a celebrity is endorsing that person. For the campaigns, it's fun, it's sexy, it gives you a little break from the traditional feed of information, but in the end, the candidate is the person that someone is voting for. It's not because a celebrity endorsed the candidate. And sometimes even, a celebrity can backfire on you because some of these folks aren't trained or equipped to talk about public policy issues. And when they end up talking about it, they stick their foot in their mouth, and you actually have to do the reverse and do some damage control because of what a celebrity said that could affect the campaign.
Yeah, I feel you, but I do think that they can drive votes and drive money, which are your other 2 points. So I would just challenge you to look at the fact that you can have influencers on your side.
I think you're being heavily challenged here, brother. You need to talk to her later. Let's take it to the next question.
Okay, hi. My question goes to Freddie, actually. It's regarding Twitter. Sorry, it's not against you. Considering that Twitter, you said that it's most effective for politics, even in USA or Latin America. Considering that, for example, in Venezuela, Twitter has become more as a tool for Venezuelan people, considering the situation for regular media such as TV, radio, or newspapers. So Twitter, I think, or my point of view is that grew up a lot or in a fast way just because of a need of population to be connected, and obviously all these leaders in the political sector are using Twitter to approach to people because of all the situation and the environment that we live in the country. So since Twitter became a tool for the followers and for the candidates or leaders, what do you think is the difference of the popularity for Twitter in the United States for government or for the followers for a specific candidate?
I think you answered it. The fact that in some of these places, it becomes the primary method to drive people to mobilize or to think about something or get informed. The Arab Spring was a product of Twitter engagement and Twitter activity. I follow a lot of Venezuela news, and without question, Twitter is the most effective tool that you have in Venezuela to mobilize the opposition and for the other side to talk the garbage that they talk. I follow Nicolás Maduro, and it's a very entertaining Twitter account, believe me. And then if you come up a little bit north to Cuba, the fact that there isn't something like Twitter widely used makes it very clear that the Cuban government doesn't want those kinds of tools to mobilize their people. Here in the U.S., we have so many more options that Twitter isn't used so much to mobilize. It's more to give your opinion or to project some kind of quick message. And the mobilization tools are different. But without question, like you said, in places where access to information is limited, Ecuador is another example, Twitter is the primary vehicle for that kind of method.
I mean, I just want to say, Twitter is a tool to mobilize in the United States. Black Lives Matter is an example of that. It just happens that Latinos, because we're so different and there isn't one Latino identity, we don't have a cause to rally around like Black Lives Matter did. But I think if there was something that would come up, I would foresee Twitter being the tool, because that's the one place where you can start a conversation and everyone joins in at once.
All right. My name is Kathy Hackle. I'm a live video influencer and a virtual reality AR evangelist. My question is actually not related to what I do, but I want to ask you about the future of Spanish language television. As we become more and more bilingual, you know, more multicultural, how does a Telemundo or a Univision or whatever need to change to adapt to the growing demands of a new generation?
That's a hard question.
I think you don't listen. Spanish broadcasting system is amazing in that we speak both languages. We're on air. If you listen to any of our stations, El Vacilón de la Mañana in New York, we speak English and we speak Spanish. Alex Sensation himself will speak English and speak Spanish. When he spins, he starts with 90s hip hop. You know, it's because the fact of the matter is, yeah, we are living both lives. So you have to be able to speak both languages. And I think that's the key. But it's not only about just the language. I would say also culturally, things like, for example, sexism, which is kind of very linked to Hispanics, and, you know, we have that horrible rap. It's changing, you know. More and more millennials are tired of this narrative of like Hispanics are hypersexual. That's reality, you know. We're tired of that, and so it's changing. It's evolving a little bit, but I mean that's what I would say.
I just want to add that as somebody that's been in media, I'm 42 and I started when I was 14 at a Spanish language radio station here in Miami. I worked at SBS. I worked at Univision before starting my business. I could tell you that there's always been this, oh, it's going to die, it's going to... And what I see is that as people want to stay connected to their roots, to their culture, to content that they care about. I mean, just look Sunday night, Telemundo, and I like always disclosing it's our client. But Telemundo at 7 o'clock launched Hasta Que Te Conocí, which is the biopic on the life of Juan Gabriel. Just went blank on Juan Gabriel. It doubled Univision's ratings on Sunday night at that time, huh? Telemundo doubled Univision's ratings that during that hour on Sunday night, and then they've been having incredible rating success for the last, I guess it's 2 months. Why? Because they're giving, I think, the audience, millennials, young people, older people, everybody, an opportunity for the family to get together, watch something together, sometimes on demand. They may not watch it live, but on demand. So like Silvana Silana with Carlos Ponce, you know, and Marisa Rodriguez, people want to watch that. You know, so it's about giving them content that they want to watch that is made in the United States, because that's something else that's important. Yes, you can bring great stuff from Colombia and from Mexico and from Brazil and from other parts of the world. Yes, definitely. But content that's made here by Latinos for Latinos, I think is really important. And I think our audience is really smart. You guys have done a great job with that at Mega TV. Our audience is very smart. Our audience knows when something is made for them, or audience knows when something was made somewhere else and is being recycled here. So I think that's what's important.
I want to add real quickly, this conversation reminds me of that famous Mark Twain quote, the rumors of my demise have been greatly exaggerated, because every year there's this conversation about how Spanish language media and Spanish language television is going to fall, and it's going to just crumble. But the facts give you a very different story, and the trend is completely in the opposite direction. The numbers are going up. I worked for Telemundo as a political analyst, and I could tell you that there are people that are watching the convention or watching the debates in English and then switching over to Telemundo to see the post-debate analysis in Spanish. And what I find is that Hispanics, whether they're born in this country or not, they tend to identify certain programming that they like in Spanish and other programming that they like in English, and they switch back and forth.
But we're still, obviously, Univision has lost viewers, let's say. They're not all going one place or the other. Some of them are going to Netflix. We are all over the place. Yeah. I mean, we are consuming media the way anybody else consumes it. Yeah. So we are on Netflix. We are on all the VOD offers out there. But the good news is that there's still an audience for language in Espanol, in our culture, and in language.
So do we have time for that one last question? All right, this is the last question. Panelists, please be short, because we have to be courteous to the next people. I'm glad that you guys are super engaged, by the way. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is Maria Milagros from Venezuela. It's a pleasure to hear your advice. My question is, which elements do you think are the best or the essentials for creating a strategy, digital marketing strategy?
For creating a marketing strategy, I think the essentials, as I mentioned earlier, are starting with a deep understanding of the consumer and who you're talking to, and really being able to leverage insights and deep, meaningful insights about what your consumer or what your customer cares about, and then being able to craft a strategy and messaging around that, and then define how it is that you're going to reach them through which vehicles and which media.
I would just say listening. Listen to your audience. They will tell you what they care about. If they don't care about it, then don't even try.
I would say, today you have to be in digital. You have to be present. You have to have a presence. But I would not overlook, at the same time, having a multimedia approach where you're also including, I hate to say the word traditional, but you're also including the other ways to reach people, because we all drive and we're all seeing billboards. You know, we're on the car, so we're listening to something. Even if it's satellite radio, that's a medium. We get home, you're watching TV. So it should be a multi-channel approach. But obviously, I feel that digital has to be the driver today. It has to be the driver. When we started República in November of 06, Twitter had started that year. Facebook had just gone from college campuses to the general population. So think about, just in 10 years, how the words coming out of my mouth have changed. I was on panels back then, 10 years ago, and it was a very, we invest some in online. No, I'm now saying, I think online has to be digital, online, whatever you call it, has to be the driver. And but you have to have a multimedia mix. It can only be that. And again, it depends on the audience too. Audience is very important. Who are you trying to target? That's king. You got to go with that first. Who is the primary target? Who do you want to reach? You know, because obviously you reach viejitos very different than you reach kids, right? And they're both very important, you know, audiences to reach. You know, the older folks have more money, you know, to spend, but kids, they're after their parents because they want them to buy something, so.
I'm going to give you the most cynical answer, because in politics, it's not what you want to say, it's saying what people want to hear. That's a fact. So in our world, research is very important to make sure that you're hitting the issues and you're describing the issues the way the audience you want to influence wants to receive it. And I know it's a cynical answer, but it's a reality. And Donald Trump is a case study on how to do that.
Thank you very much, everybody. Let's hear it for them. Let's hear it for you guys. You had a lot of great questions. And I'll finish with thanking his Social Media Week Miami. Demon Media has a series of other sessions today. So if you're interested in U.S. Hispanic marketing or other influencer sessions, stick around. Also, Hispanicize will be having an event later next month. So be on the lookout. And thank you very much, everybody. Thank you.